So that's the end of the second chapter. Through this chapter, we got started with the Java language basics. We have taken a top-down approach in learning the concepts. That is, we first introduced the concept of object-oriented programming by explaining what classes and objects are. We then studied variables, methods, and constructors in detail, which are the core building blocks of a class. We also looked at our first data structure of the course, which is an array. Now let's just look at some of the important points we covered in this chapter. We started with looking at object-oriented programming, which helps model real-world scenarios in a more natural way. In Java, an object is used to represent a real-world entity like a student. And objects are defined using a class. That is, class is like a blueprint, and objects are instances of a class. Next, we looked at variables. A variable is simply a container that holds something. And the type of data that a variable can hold is defined at the variable creation time itself by stating the variable's type. So once a variable's type is defined, it can only hold data of that particular type and it cannot hold any other type of data. And due to this, Java is referred to as a statically typed language. A variable's type can be either a primitive type or a class name. And we saw that in Java, we have 8 primitive data types. And we also saw that there are 3 kinds of variables: instance, static, and local variables. Instance variables are unique to each object and they hold an object's state. Static variables are class variables that are shared across all objects of the class. Finally, local variables are defined within methods or constructors. Even method parameters and constructor parameters are considered as local variables. We next looked at arrays. In Java, an array is an object. That is, it gets stored on the heap like any other regular Java object. And it is used to store fixed number of elements of a single type. And the type can be either primitive or object reference. Arrays support fast random access. And by fast here, we mean constant time. So accessing 1000th element would take the same amount of time as accessing the 5th element. We next looked at methods, which basically represent behavior. And Java always uses pass-by-value mechanism while passing data to methods. Even for object references, we know that it passes a copy of the memory address of the object. We then looked at method overloading, where within the same class, we can have multiple methods with the same name but different parameterless. To be considered a valid overload, method parameters must be different. Finally, we looked at constructors. A constructor is invoked when an object is being created, and it is typically used to initialize object state. And we can have multiple constructors in the same class, and this invocation statement is used to invoke an overloaded constructor. And this invocation statement must also be the first statement in the constructor. And that's about it. Thanks for listening, and we will continue learning more language basics in the next chapter.